Now, we're going to invite questions, but I'm going to have the privilege of the first question. And I want to ask Jimmy, how much protein should we eat, Jimmy? And how do we know how much protein we're having?
Listen to my talk in about 30 minutes. No, seriously. Protein is one of those things we always hear a low-carb diet is a high-protein diet. We've heard that. I've heard that forever. So, okay, chicken breast and salad. That's pretty low-carb, right? You're going to find out in about 30 minutes. That's a big mistake.
Any more? Christine, have you got a comment on protein?
Well, actually, you can't overeat protein if you have a high-fat diet. So the more fat you eat, then that's a natural way to regulate your protein intake.
I just recently tweaked my protein intake because I probably originally, when I started low carb paleo, I thought it was, you know, free license to eat as much protein as I wanted. And then I started, the weight started creeping back on, and you know, I was having huge gut issues, feeling really fatigued all the time. And then I listened to, I think it was your podcast with Jenny Rule, about, in some sense, calories still do matter. It's just the quality and you're getting from. And protein will be converted into glucose if you eat too much of it. And that's something I've learned. So I actually got quite diligent for a while and measured out my protein. I worked out how much I needed in a day, and I worked out that about 65 grams of protein is good for me, and that's about 300 grams of white meat in a day. And then I worked out how much fat I needed to balance it out. It was quite a lot, and I thought, I don't know if I'm going to be able to get up to that. But it's been an absolute pleasure trying. Pork crackling and being good friends.
Yeah, I'll add something there too. When we're talking about fertility, which can be a little bit different because we're trying to gear you in a different direction, I try to get patients to gear towards 80 to 100 grams a day, and I suggest that they look at their physique to know that's sort of a rough guide for your body, if it's a new thing you're doing, to sort of, as a rough guide anyway.
How much protein in an egg?
6.5 to 7 grams, depending on the size. So it's 3 grams in the yolk and 3 grams in the white.
So I can have my 3-egg omelet and I'm not going to be... Yeah, I mean, I hear numbers of something like 1 to 1.5 grams per kilogram. That's probably more lean body mass. So if you're 186 kilos, you can't have... you can't have 186 grams of protein. But, so I'm just curious on that because I get the feeling that for some of us, we have to tweak our protein. We can't go all out on the protein, even though we're very low carb.
So I recently interviewed on my Ask Low Carb Experts podcast a gentleman named Dr. Donald Layman, who's a world-renowned protein expert, and he says if you're going to eat your protein, split it up into that 3 meal, so that 80 to 100 you were just talking about would look like 30, 30, 30 in each meal. So you spread it out each meal, and that's how you distribute.
Is that working? Yes. I do 20-20-20 and then 10 sets is what I try and gear the patients towards. Yeah, just to break it down here.
I mean, I found it was an interesting point that protein, some of the amino acids in protein convert to glucose. And therein lies the rub. You can't just have unlimited protein because that will get converted to glucose and that will create the insulin response and that can cause fat storage. So, the audience, what would you like to ask the experts? Yes, thank you.
I'm just wondering what that 75% of fat looks like on your dinner plate.
Yeah, okay. It sounds like, you picture my plate and I'll look at it as the fat. That's not how it works. It's just total calories. is 75%. So say I reckon I eat roughly 2,000 calories a day. 75% of those calories are from fat, but they're only in actual size on a spoon. It's very little because obviously the calorie gains. So that's how it works. But for me, salmon, sardines, eggs, 1 or 2 teaspoons of coconut oil a day. And that's what it looks like. It's basically fat from foods. I don't eat a big plate of butter.
Yes, thank you.
I can't remember the actual numbers, but I remember when I first went in before I started paleo, because I think, you know, I was looking into why I was having such stomach pain, so I had to do a full test then. And my doctor pointed out that my total cholesterol, which is 30 years ago, as we heard earlier today, we shouldn't really go by that, but my bad cholesterol was actually bordering the very top end of what it should be. And seeing I was 30 at the time, those are not great numbers to have. When I went in 3 months after I changed my diet, that number had gone down. I can't remember now the exact numbers, but yeah, my good cholesterol had gone up, the bad had gone down, and the triglycerides were way down. Because I went from eating sugar, you know, I'd say easily 300 grams of carbs a day. Yep, big change.
And I remember Ken Sakaris in his talk this morning say triglycerides are a much better marker than any of the other things. In fact, some of the other markers are so confusing that it's, you know, some people even say you shouldn't even get tested, basically. And what are you going to do about it if it's high? And I'm going to say the only thing you're going to do is go on a good diet. You're going to go on a statin, and I think there'd be a number of us here who think that statins are way overprescribed. They cost us a fortune, and they have unfortunate side effects like dementia and type 2 diabetes. So there might be a very small proportion of people for whom there is a benefit, but for the vast majority of people who are on them, they're not likely to be doing much. Yes.
Starting school next year, so I don't really like to do lunchboxes, but it will be a lot of gluten-free bread with, you know, butter, cheese, they have dairy, fruit, veggies. I can't give them eggs because they want to eat eggs on their own. They do like quiches, like a ham slice, but I haven't made one yet, and they're when they go to their nan and pop. But I think that will be something I'll do next year.
Christo, could we hear from you for that question about the children and how you handle it, because you've got some really great ideas.
Oh, there you are.
That's me.
Thanks. Yes, our kids are really good now because they've been educated on how we eat and how it affects us and all that sort of stuff. So they actually make their own decisions now, which is great. And in fact, when my son went to high school, he went a bit crazy, but I didn't forbid him to do it. So he was making his own decisions. So he would actually come home and say, well, I feel really crap, but I can't stop, because it was just this new thing. But eventually he came to his own decision to stop doing that. So now he's 17 and he eats a really good diet, which is really unusual for a 17-year-old. And he's decided he'll splash out once a month. So, you know, he decides which points he's going to do that and then he does it. So, you know, that's quite good. But we also have, there's a lot of different ideas you can use for lunch boxes, like even things like meatballs, sweet potato slice. I can't think of a lot of them off the top of my head, but there's so many things you can chuck in their lunch boxes and get away from the whole bread and all that sort of stuff. You know, they don't have to have sandwiches, there's so much stuff. Sausages, like little shepherd pies. You know, it's not as nice as cold, but it's still really delicious, and they love the potato as well.
Coming round, is the mic coming?
Just wondering what your thoughts are on natural sweeteners like stevia and xylitol.
Mine or?
Start with you, Kristen.
So, this is the thing with natural sweeteners. There are so many different opinions on what's good and what's not. My favourite is stevia. Now, some people talk about stevia being bitter. Has anyone experienced that? I'm surprised I went more hands. Now, there are good brands you can get that aren't bitter, but they've taken that bitter component out. So it doesn't have to be bitter. It's actually a really nice sweetener. It's got no fructose in it. So it's a fantastic sweetener. Now, the other contentious one is raw honey. So a lot of you probably avoid honey now, right? Who avoids honey? So, to me, raw honey is a nutritious food. And it's got high fructose levels in it, so we limit it, so we use small amounts, but it's a very nutritious food. So I'd much rather do that than use something like a highly processed product like dextrose. But it works for a lot of people. So you kind of got to think about where you're coming from, what you want to achieve, and then kind of see, well, what's the best sweetener for me? And look at all the different opinions.
Yeah, it's always going to be, nothing's a one-size-fits-all. You've got to work out what works for you, your lifestyle, and if it means that you can have a birthday party, say, and you know you can provide a really cool spread for kids, then you might look at what your alternatives are, and that might even be a treat as well. But that comes back to that whole, you know, what do you put in kids' lunch boxes and parties and stuff like that. It's also about educating other parents, I think. Sorry, that's still coming back to that question. I want to add that before. Educating other parents as to why you might not want your kids to eat a certain way, which is interesting because when they start to find out more, they want to know and they want to do the same for their kids, and it's an inspiring thing as well. So, yeah, I think that you're spot on with the sweeteners, and I would agree. And I do agree, raw honey is a fabulous therapeutic food. Like, you know, it's rich in antibiotic properties, and there's so many reasons why you might at certain times need to add that. But there are alternatives to that as well. So it is just coming back to trial and error for each individual person and each individual household.
I'm a recovering sweet addict, so I love stevia, I love raw honey. I use 100% organic maple syrup when I bake. So just talking about the quantities, like raw honey, I think it's a great sweetener. When I make a batch of paleo brownies, which is, you know, a big tray, I need about 1.5 teaspoon of raw honey to sweeten all the day. And that's not a lot when you put it in context. And then, yeah, and because it's so sweet, you don't need much and you still get that lovely sort of burnt sand or sort of, yeah, anyway. But I have to back into my diet, and I noticed that I preferred things sweeter and sweeter and sweeter, and I was getting back into that feedback loop where food became a reward. I would have lunch and then I'd instantly go, now I need something sweet. That's a very bad habit for me, and I've gone cold turkey again. So until I feel strong enough to actually be able to. Yeah, well, I was going to say I've had problems with Candida overgrowth in my gut, so I tend to easily crave sugary.
So we never use over a teaspoon a day of honey, so that's kind of regard.
I just want to say too that quite often when you do cut out sugar, everything tastes sweet. Like your sensitivity to sweetness is amazing. Like I don't have any sugar and I'm the same as I do. You know, Steve's like a gateway drug to me. Like it's just, you know, I do have, actually about 90% chocolate cocoa, and that's amazing. But I mean, I've had my friends that eat sugar all the time, try it, and they say it's disgusting, it's so bitter. And I think it's like, oh, this is so sweet. To me, pumpkin's sweet now, and pork is sweet, and sweet potatoes. Incredibly sweet, so you actually don't need to have that, or I find, I just don't need to have that level of sweetness in my diet at all. It's really tasty.
Well, and I would only say that if you think it's a culprit, test. That's the only way you can know for sure. Test how you feel, how you look, feel, performance, or what left to say. And then test your blood sugar, which I'm going to do during my presentation here in a minute to show you how easy it is.
I was just wondering if you do have health concerns that you want to investigate, how you find a health professional to help you, since so many aren't conventional and look at you like you're crazy, and like what have you been reading when you say, can you test this for me, like we won't test that unless you're actually about to die or something, and how do you find something to help you?
So I did a podcast on Ask the Low Carb Experts, it's a really good podcast I hear, with a lady named Dr. Mary Berman earlier this year. You'll type in Mary Vernon, and the topic was how to talk to your non-paleo, low-carb friendly physician. And it's literally all the questions you could ever want to know, so try to listen to that. She really gave, she basically said, you're the boss, and you're basically the consumer. You tell that doctor what you want, and if they don't do it, you fire them, you go to the next one.
I was going to say quickly,
I use an naturopath. They're very good. You can also find integrative practitioners that know a bit about everything, and there are a few of them. But the best thing, like you're saying to me, get yourself educated to ask the questions that you need. I, time and time again, I have a son that has cystic fibrosis, so we're in the medical system all of a sudden, and it's amazing when you start to ask the questions. Very often that there's answers that no one knows. So you've got a best to, you know, get yourself educated so that you can ask the questions that you need answered yourself, and then a lot of that will come back to you exploring what you need to, and then asking for those specific tests as well.
Can we go back to kids again? Can maybe the parents tell me if they had any luck getting the sugar supply at school? Maybe drinks and food supplied by the school canteen, or some teachers use lollies or chocolates as a reward for behaviour in the classroom. Has anyone had any lunch at any of that issue?
I worked on this for years, and I can't say I was successful. It's very, very difficult. It's like a memory, you know. I did presentations in a school that our children used to go to, and would teach the children about sugar and all the chemicals that were in foods that they were eating. And then they'd get lollies handed by the teacher the next day. So it's a very confusing message. So
one thing that is in favour, a little bit, it's not a good thing, but there's so many food intolerances nowadays, you can get around things a little bit more, or you can, you know, educate, like I said before, and people actually start to listen because there are so many intolerances. I think I'm lucky that, you know, where my daughter goes to kinder, at least it's quite limited as to what you can take. It's pretty much fruit and veggies only. So, you know, but, you know, at the end of the school term, I still get a bag of lollies. So it is something that's going to be a constant battle. But I think also educating the kids, like I said before, is key for that.
The school might be for starting next year. They proudly told us they've cleaned up the tuck shop, but it's still chicken nuggets and blueberry rice. The chicken nugget has something like nearly 40 ingredients. So it's still a clean eating, but I think the sugar is slowly being taken out.
Better make this the last question because it's afternoon tea time.
Hi, I find it challenging to get creative with making complete proteins because I'm vegetarian. So do you have any advice with that? And I noticed that the leaves, perhaps they've got some enzyme inhibitors or something soaking or something like that. What can you say to me?
I think soaking, I heard it's good, like activating the nuts. Are you familiar with that? Yep, so soaking and basically drying the nuts for a long time. That will improve some of the acidic acid. I think soaking your beans, if you use dry beans, you need to soak them in 12 hours. Yep, overnight. I've done a bit of reading about this because I get a lot of questions from vegetarians regarding vegetarians around the world. And I came across in one of the books, the whole line of saying pea, hemp and rice protein is a good source of adding proteins into your diet. And you have to be very careful because I've been a vegetarian myself and I know the tendency is to replace protein with carbs. You just got to be aware of that and then try to make sure you get enough of your body weight.
Yeah, eggs, eat a lot of eggs because you can't really get the true protein from combining. So eggs, coconut oil, butter. And bacon, you can't really do it healthily. Just can't do it. So.
Okay, look, thank you very much. We'll adjourn for about 20 minutes, maybe a little bit longer for a cuppa, and look forward to hearing Jimmy on return.